We know the greater omentum is on anterior side, and posteriorly there is pancreas and lesser sac is there. So, and we know there are two curvatures, two orifices, cardiac and pylorus, and the fundus, body and neck of the stomach is there. The important lies in this gastric blood supply, and left gastric artery, right gastric artery, right gastroepiploic, left gastroepiploic, and short gastric arteries. The importance lies because once the carcinoma is there, we are going to resect the stomach. So we must know how much the area of the stomach is supplied by which artery. So that is important, and we are going to know by this arterial supply diagrammatic representation, in which the right gastric artery is supplying mostly the right side of the stomach, and the left gastric artery and left gastroepiploic is supplying the, as well as the short gastrics by the splenic artery, it is also supplying the major portion of the stomach. The lymphatic drainage is along the vessels. Histology, it has serous layer, muscular layer, submucous layer, and the mucous layer. Physiology, as we know, the digestion of the food is reduced, the size of the of the food, and it acts as a reservoir. The absorption of vitamin B12 and iron and calcium is in the stomach. The stimulant of the gastric secretion, gastrin, parietal cells, gastrin secreted by the parietal cell, acetylcholine is by the vagus, and it stimulates the gastric cells. Histamine mast cell is important because the parietal and the chief cell also secretes the histamine from the mast cells, and it acts on the mast cells. Carcinoma of the stomach, we are going to discuss the clinical presentation, the diagnosis, staging, treatment and screening. This is the worldwide incidence of the gastric cancer has been falling in most of the group of the countries. The red zone is the high zone, intermediate is the orange zone, and the green zone is the low incidence zones. So we see the major portion still is having a high incidence of the cancers. The spectrum of the gastric cancer, it is the proposed progression, the chronic gastritis, the chronic gastric atrophic gastritis, and intestinal metaplasia, dysplasia, and adenocarcinoma. H. pylori infection, as we know, it has a strong association in the gastric ulcer formation as well as in the gastric carcinoma as well. Superficial gastritis, atrophic gastritis, intestinal metaplasia, dysplasia, and then the cancer. In the risk factors of the gastric cancer, the diet hai nitrosamines is a compound which is mostly used in the preservatives and in certain foods. So the diet which contains these nitrous compounds, this has got the risk factor for the gastric cancer. Low fruit, vegetable, high fried food, processed meat, all has got the association with the gastric cancer. High salt intake is also associated. Obesity and smoking, yes, alcohol is also linked as a risk factor for the gastric cancer. H. pylori, as we discussed, low socioeconomic areas, the H. pylori association with gastric cancer and the gastric ulcer is there. Hereditary diffuse gastric cancers, 40 to 67% lifetime risk of for men, and 60 to 83% for the woman. Immigrants from endemic areas maintain native country risk क्या हो जाता है, risk of two offspring similar to the H. pylori a major cause of the stomach cancer, especially cancer in the lower distal part of the stomach, may lead to the inflammation, chronic atrophic gastritis, and precancerous changes of the inner lining of the stomach. Stomach cancer is more common in men than in women, so it is also called a captain's men's death. Mainly, it is in the men. There is a sharp increase in the stomach cancer after the age of 50 years. Most people diagnosed with stomach cancer are in their late 60s, 70s, and 80s. It is the second most common cause of cancer worldwide and 10th most common malignancy in the United States. Ethnicity, it is most common in Asian and Pacific islands, and gastric cancer is common in the Japanese individual. So Japanese, in the Japan, every one individual has to undergo for the screening endoscopies. For this reason, nowadays the carcinoma of stomach is presented earlier to them. So early gastric cancer presentation commonly presents to Japanese, and they are having a very good outcome and survival after the resection of the and after the treatment of the surgeries, because the again because of the early presentation. Diet and increased risk of the stomach cancer is seen with diets containing large amounts of smoked food. So individuals, those who are taking the smoked food, saltish fish and meat and pickled vegetables, the khas, especially the people, those who are eating the barbecue type of food, and especially the smoked food, they are having the more chances of development of the cancer. Nitrites and nitrates are substances commonly found in the cured meats. They can be converted by certain bacteria such as H. pylori into compounds that have been to cause stomach cancer in animals. On the other hand, eating fresh fruits and vegetables that contains antioxidants such as A and C appears to lower the risk cancer. So in the risk factors, the male gender, family history, polyposis syndrome, nitrates, high salt consumption, low socioeconomic, pickled food, adenomatous gastric polyps, previous gastric resection, meniere's disease, and smoking, H. pylori, and chronic gastritis. These are all related. Like smoking increases the stomach cancer, particularly for cancers of the upper portion of the stomach closest to the esophagus. The rate of the stomach cancer is about doubled in smokers. Obesity, being overweight or obese, has emerged as a possible cause of the cancer of the cardia, the part of the stomach nearest the esophagus, but the strength of this link is not yet clear. For unknown reason, individuals with type A blood have an increased risk of developing the gastric cancer. People with several first degree relatives who have had stomach cancer are more likely to develop this disease. So again, previous surgery, pernicious anemia, Meniere's disease, these all are associated inherited cancer syndromes. Like hereditary diffuse gastric cancer is an inherited condition that greatly increases the risk of developing stomach cancer. This condition is quite rare, but the lifetime stomach cancer risk among the affected people is about 70 to 80%. Researchers recently discovered the gene ICA, TYRN, and CDH1 responsible for this condition. Hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer are known as Lynch syndrome, or familial adenomatous polyposis coli are also inherited genetic disorders. They cause a greatly increased risk of getting colorectal cancer and a slightly increased risk of getting stomach cancer in family members who have these genes mutations. People who carry mutations of inherited breast cancer genes like BRCA1 and BRCA2 may also have a higher rate of the stomach cancer. Precursors of the gastric cancer: adenomatous polyps, chronic atrophic gastritis, pernicious gastritis, Meniere's disease, previous gastric surgery for non-cancerous conditions. If we go and discuss the symptoms, there are no specific symptoms, but you can have a significant weight loss in 62% of the individuals, abdominal pain in 52% of the individual, nausea 34, and dysphagia, if especially the stomach cancer is the cardiac end of the stomach, and early satiety, it is 18% of the individuals, and ulcer type pain in 17%. Dysphagia more common with proximal gastric tumor, and occult GI bleeding less than 20%, overt bleeding less than 20%, and GI bleeding very common, this occult GI bleeding, which can be more commonly seen. Signs, you may not find any sign earlier in the disease, but in the later stages one can able to find a palpable mass in the epigastric region or a vague mass, sometimes a palpable Virchow's lymph node, which is the left supraclavicular lymph node, periumbilical nodular swelling, Sister Mary Joseph nodule, which could be present in the widespread spread of the tumor or the intraperitoneal spread of the tumor. So it is an advanced stage sign which can also be picked by the physician. Left axillary lymph node, which is the Irish lymph node, very rarely one can find a left axillary lymph node which is an Irish nodule. And enlarged ovaries, Krukenberg's tumor, if the tumor is the carcinoma of the stomach is in the females, we can find a bulky palpable mass, ovarian masses in the pelvis, or in advanced stages the ascites can also be picked as a sign. In then investigations, the routine blood examination like low hemoglobin, high ESR, stool for occult blood, gastric function test, this can reveal gross hypo and achloridia. Endoscopy, this is the gold standard for the diagnosis of the stomach cancer. Not only you can able to find where the cancer lies, like in the cardia, body, fundus, or in the pylorus or pre-pyloric region, but one can able to get the biopsy as well, because this is not only diagnostic, but for the confirmation of your diagnosis you have to do this endoscopy. So endoscopy is the gold standard investigation and investigation of choice for the patients who are presenting with the sign and symptoms of gastric cancer. Ultrasonography can help to assess the thickening of the gastric wall, local invasion, peritoneal involvement, ascites, involvement of the liver, and the carcinomatosis can be picked by the ultrasound. CT scan, to an extent one can find the extent of the disease, involvement of the lymph node, and the liver metastasis. Barium studies, one can able to get the again the location and the involvement of the stomach, but nowadays very less frequently these barium studies are being performed because of the easy availability of the endoscopies and the skillful endoscopic procedure has less complication nowadays. Previously there were chances of perforations and were high once the earlier days when the endoscopy was invented, but now the endoscopies can easily be performed, so nowadays no or very less or very rarely the perforated esophagus and perforated stomach can be seen during the endoscopies. So barium studies is very less frequently performed. Staging laparoscopy, yes, we are going to discuss why, what is the importance of this staging laparoscopy. So again, endoscopy is a gold standard. The biopsy can be taken, sensitivity is 70%, 7 biopsies from the ulcer can be taken, and the sensitivity is more than 98% once the 7 biopsies are taken from the ulcer. Brush cytology increases the sensitivity of the single biopsies, aid in multiple biopsy and clear. Preoperative staging by the abdominal and the pelvic CT scanning, endoscopic ultrasound and depth of the tumor. The endoscopic ultrasound has got the importance for the assessment of the primary tumor. Like we can able to see the lamina propria is involved or muscularis propria is involved, or the tumor is go beyond the mucosa, and also the enlarged perigastric celiac lymph nodes can be assessed easily by the endoscopic ultrasound. So this is how, this is again a very good investigation nowadays for the assessment of the primary tumor. Yes, the endoscopic ultrasound, small high frequency ultrasound transducer incorporated into the distal end of the endoscope, as you can see in the picture. Advantages: superior resolution, image not compromised by intervening gases, and a lesion as small as 2 to 3 millimeter in diameter can be imaged. This is the picture of the endoscopic ultrasound. Like in the T1 stage, when the only the mucosa is involved and it is not beyond the lamina propria, and T2 where it goes and penetrates the lamina propria, and T3 where the muscularis propria, muscularis mucosa is involved, and the T4 when it goes beyond the serosa. Barium studies, as it has got the false negative in as many as 50% of the cases. Sensitivity is as low as 14% in early cases. May be superior to esophageal gastric esophageal gastroduodenoscopy, like endoscopy or pergi endoscopy, for lenitis plastica. Yes, lenitis plastica, which is spreads beneath the mucosa. So this kind of the tumor can be more easily picked by the barium studies than by the endoscopies, because in the endoscopy you will find the normal mucosa, but it spreads beyond the or beneath the mucosa. And upper GI endoscopy may be normal, while leather bottle will be apparent on radiograph. So it has got an importance in the lenitis plastica cases, which is a kind of a tumor where it is involving the whole of the stomach and it gets like a leather bottle stomach. Staging laparoscopy, why it is being done with the gastric carcinoma? Because most of the time the CT scan is not able to pick the liver metastasis and the seedling, the peritoneal spread of the tumor by the CT scan is not picked, so we have to perform the staging laparoscopy, because the spread of the celiac spread or the spread in the peritoneal spread is not picked because it is isomeric with the with the liver secondaries, so it is not being picked. So the staging laparoscopy is should be done in the cases of the carcinoma of the stomach. Gastric cancer bilocation, if you see 50 to 60% in the distal part and about 25% in the body and 25% in the cardiac end of the stomach. Malignant neoplasm of the stomach, adenocarcinoma 94%, lymphoma 4%, malignant GIST, gastrointestinal and stromal tumor 1%. Hematogenous spread is breast and malignant melanoma, and direct spread of the pancreas, liver, colon and ovaries could be there as the nearby structures. Gastric carcinomas, gastric cancer, it has two systems, Japanese classification, more elaborative and anatomically based, and Western developed by the American Joint Committee on on Cancer, AJCC, and International Union Against Cancer, UICC, more widely used. Tumor at the gastroesophageal junction of in cardia of stomach within 5 cm of the gastric, so the cardiac end cancer should be taken as the or should be staged as an esophageal staging, because the cardia, if you remove the cardia, you cannot remove the only cardia, you have to remove the lower portion of the esophagus as well. So this is nowadays being taken up by the lower esophageal cancer, the cardiac end of the esophagus. The classification, depth of invasion, the early gastric cancer, and when the mucosa and submucosa is involved, advanced cancer into or through the muscularis propria. Macroscopic growth pattern, Ming classification, expanding, infiltrative, lineatus plastica, and histological type, intestinal or diffuse gastric, poorly differentiated gastric cancer. The intestinal type of the cancer, it is basically the Lorraine classification is most widely used and divides into the gastric cancer into two types, intestinal type and the diffuse type. The intestinal type is of cancer are 30% of the cases and are glandular rise from the gastric mucosa, more common in elderly men, in the distal stomach associated with H. pylori and other environmental exposure that lead to chronic gastritis, atrophy and intestinal metaplasia and dysplasia. Hematogenous spread of the metastatic spread to the distant organ is seen. The diffuse type of cancer, it is about in 70% of the individual, often with signet ring cells type, arise from the lamina propria, associated with invasive gastric pattern with rapid and submucosal spread, occur commonly in young individuals. The intestinal type is common in elderly. This is common in younger individual. The intestinal type is common in male. However, this is common in females, the diffuse type. The diffuse type involves the proximal stomach. However, intestinal type involves the distal stomach. The transmural and lymphatic spread with the early metastatic cancer are more common. It has worse overall prognosis, common in Western resource-rich countries. Proximal gastric cancer does not seem to be associated with H. pylori infection. It is associated with obesity, higher socioeconomic class. Once the diagnosis is established, we have to do the CT scan and endoluminal ultrasound, PET scan, CT scan, laparoscopic staging in order to get the proper diagnosis, as we have discussed earlier. So these are the classification. It could be adenocarcinoma, papillary adenocarcinoma, tubular adenocarcinoma, mucinous adenocarcinoma, signet ring cell signet ring cell type carcinoma, adenosquamous carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, small cell carcinoma, undifferentiated carcinoma, and others. Lorentz classification we have discussed. Ming classification, expanding type, intestinal type. If you see the early gastric cancer, it can present as type 1, protruding type, type 2, superficial type, type 3, 2B, 2A as a superficial type, 2B as a flat type. We can see in the picture, superficial type little elevated, the flat type is just flat as, and depressed type, you can see the 2C, which is little depressed. However, excavated type, which is type 3, is just excavated from the mucosa. Or it could be papillary, tubular, or mucinous and signet ring type. The spread is direct, lymphatic, hematogenous, and transilomic. We can see the gastric cancer flat type picture is like this, which can be seen in the picture. Gastric carcinoma superficial type can be seen in the other picture. The third type, ulcerative type, you can see easily the ulcerative lesion, and the gastric carcinoma polypoid type, you can see a polypoidal growth in the rugae of the stomach. Excavating type and depressed type can be seen in the picture. And the gastric carcinoma of a diffuse type, lenitis plastica, where the mucosa is normal and the stomach is like a leather bottle. Lenitis plastica, diffuse type gastric cancer, tumor often infiltrate the submucosa and muscularis propria, and the superficial biopsies may be falsely negative. So this is very important that you can get the falsely negative biopsies in these patients. And so one has to take the greater chunk of the tissue rather than the superficial only. Combination of a strip and a bit bite biopsy needed, and suspicion of lenitis plastica. This is the radiological picture of the lenitis plastica. You can easily see the stomach is like a leather bottle. Staging workup, you have to have a biopsy, you have to have a CT scan for the staging or metastasis of the disease. You need to do the laparoscopic biopsy, you need to perform the endoluminal ultrasound to see the depth of the tumor. Exact depth of the tumor can be assessed by the endoluminal ultrasound. PET scan, nowadays it is also available in our setup of JPMC as well, and we are the only center where the PET scan in the whole of the country is being performed free of cost. So PET scan is available in JPMC now. A more sensitive then the CT scan for detection of the distant metastasis, also useful for detecting lymph nodes. Negative PET not helpful. Even large tumors can be falsely negative if metabolic activity is low. So most diffuse gastric cancer signet ring are not FDG avid. Yes, serological studies, which is tumor markers, CEA, CA125, CA19-9 and CA27-4 may be elevated but have low sensitivity and specificity. None are diagnostic. Preoperative elevation and markers usually pretend high risk of adverse outcome. No serologic finding should exclude surgical considerations. This is the TNM staging of the gastric cancer. TX not assessed, not no evidence of the tumor, TIS, carcinoma in situ, T1, tumor invades the lamina propria, T1A, tumor invades the lamina propria or muscularis mucosa, T1B, tumor invades the submucosa, T2, tumor invades the muscularis propria, T3, tumor penetrates the subserosa connective tissue without invasion of the visceral peritoneum or adjacent structures. T4, tumor invades the serosa, visceral peritoneum or adjacent structures. T4A, tumor invades the serosa, visceral peritoneum. T4, tumor invades the adjacent structures. Regional lymph node, TX not assessed, NX not assessed, N0, no regional lymph node, N1, 1 to 2 regional lymph node, N2, 3 to 6 regional lymph nodes, N3 metastasis is seen or more regional lymph nodes, N3A metastasis in 7 to 15 regional lymph nodes, N3B metastasis in 16 or more regional lymph nodes, distant metastasis. Yes, you can see T1. Mucosa only, T2, yes, lamina propria, then T4 beyond the serosa. Treatment, loco-regional stage 1 to 3 disease, potentially curable. Multidisciplinary evaluation and consideration of the surgery. Advanced stage 4 disease, palliative therapy, studies indicate longer survival and better quality of life. You can see here the extent of the gastric resection depends on the tumor size, location and depth of the invasion. If the tumor is in the distal stomach, you have to resect the distal stomach, and remaining proximal stomach could be anastomose with the jejunum. This is called gastric bypass, or this is called Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy, where the duodenum is closed. You can see easily in the picture the duodenum is cut and the first part of the duodenum is closed. However, the proximal part of the stomach is being anastomose with the jejunum, not with the duodenum. So this is gastrojejunostomy, or you can call Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy. Here you can see once the tumor is involved in the proximal stomach, the body of the stomach, you have to remove the whole of the stomach because you need a resection margin of at least 5 cm. So you have to resect the whole of the stomach. You cannot do the wedge resection. You cannot do, in this case, the partial gastrectomy. So the whole of the stomach is removed. The jejunum is being anastomosed with the esophagus, not the duodenum. Why? Because if you do the anastomosis of duodenum with the esophagus, there will be more reflux. The patient will, outcome will be more, you can say, mutilating. So this kind of surgery should not be done. You have to do the closure of the duodenum, and then you have to take the proximal part of the jejunum to be anastomosed with the proximal part of the jejunum should be anastomosed with the jejunum, and take the distal one, the cut distal part, to the esophagus and anastomose the jejunum with the esophagus. This is called esophagojejunostomy and Roux-en-Y. You can easily see this Y. This Y is there. So this is called. Or you can make a inverted J-shaped pouch by the jejunum. These are the few methods by which you can do the resection of the stomach, especially the distal complete gastrectomy in these cases. In Japanese Research Society for Gastric Cancer, 16 lymph node locations were classified into 4 concentric groups, and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So this is N1, you can see with the at the picture, N2 the perigastric lymph nodes, N3 again the group of the lymph nodes which are perigastric, and N4 you can see the stomach, the perigastric lymph nodes. The extra epigastric lymph nodes are the lymph nodes from beyond 7 to 15 are the extra epigastric lymph nodes, which can be easily seen in this picture. What is the ideal extent of the lymphadenectomy? D0 removal is the removes less than all the relevant lymph nodes, N1 lymph nodes. D1 removes N1 nodes only, the left and the right gastrics, the left and the right gastroepiploic, and sub and the suprapyloric lymph nodes. D2 removes all the N1 and N2 lymph nodes, left gastric, common hepatic, celiac and the splenic, hilum and along the splenic artery. D3 removes all the N2 and N3 lymph nodes. So early gastric cancers are defined as the tumor that these are the tumor which is confined to the mucosa or the submucosa and have limited propensity for the lymph node metastasis and may be treated by limited gastric resection. So resection is the where you remove the perigastric lymph nodes. The D2 lymph nodes, removal of the lymph node along the left gastric, hepatic, splenic and the celiac arteries. In Japanese, at least D2 gastrectomy, removal of the second tier of the nodes is performed on all the operable gastric cancers. Some centers are practicing more radical surgery, D3 and even D4 resections. D2 and D4 resection, oncological outcome may be better following D2 gastrectomy, but this operation is associated with higher level of morbidity and perioperative mortality. Most of this morbidity and mortality relates to the removal of the spleen with or without distal pancreas, because if you want to do the D3 and D4 resections, you have to remove the spleen and the distal pancreas as well. So the chances of mortality and morbidity will be higher in this case. The traditional D2 radical gastrectomy removes the spleen and the distal pancreas and block with the stomach. In Japanese, D2 gastrectomy will commonly preserve the spleen and the pancreas, and this practice is widely accepted by the specialized center in the Western countries as well. So these are the few methods by which you can do the resections of the tumor. Prognosis related to, if you see the TIS, like in situ zero stage tumor, the you can find percentage of cases only 1%, but it has got 90% survival, 5-year survival. Stage 1A, where only the submucosa is involved, 7% of the cases are seen in this way, and at this stage, and the 5-year survival is 59%. 1B, node negative invasion of the lamina muscularis propria, 10% of the cases are this is American Cancer Society data. So Japanese has more cases in the early stage tumors. So in America, as they are not doing the routine upper GI endoscopies, however screening endoscopies is more commonly being done in the Japan, so they have more and more cases of the, but we don't have the Japanese data, we have the American data available. So they have 44% of the survival, 5-year survival. In stage 3, 21% of the patients, so more commonly patients are presented in the stage 3 and 4 diseases rather than stage 1 and 2, even in America. So what to talk of our countries? We are normally having the stage 3 and 4 diseases, not stage 1 or 2. So the 3B has only 9% survival and stage 4 has only 3% survival. The adjuvant and the new adjuvant chemotherapies has got a role in the prevention of the cancer. So it has for gastric cancer has potential for improving patient's tolerance, resectability rate, downstaging, and overall patient survival with this adjuvant and neoadjuvant therapies. Epirubicin, cisplatin, 5-fluorouracil, these are the commonly used chemotherapies which are available. Radiotherapy, routine use of radiotherapy is controversial as the result of the clinical trial are inconclusive. Radiotherapy has a role in palliative treatment and painful bony metastasis. Palliative chemotherapy can be done or can be given in many patients. If you see stage-wise, stage 0, because of the cancer is limited to the mucosa, this stage can be this stage can be treated by the surgery alone. No chemotherapy is needed. Stage 2, surgery plus radio or chemotherapy alone. Stage 3, surgery plus chemo alone or before and after the surgery. Stage 4 disease, a surgery, palliative resection such as gastric bypass or even subtotal gastrectomy to restore the continuity of the stomach, and laser beam fulguration of the tumor by endoscopy and the self-expanding metallic stent. The targeted therapies can also be given in the treatment of the advanced stomach cancers, and this is Herceptin. Herceptin is a disease, is a drug which could be used in the breast cancer. Nowadays, can be used in the as a palliative targeted therapy for the stomach cancer. Recurrent cancers, the advanced incurable cancer, the radiotherapy external or internal can be given, like brachytherapy, internal and external beam therapy. Monoclonal antibodies therapy, this can also be tried in a patients who are trastuzumab and these are the drugs which can be used in a patients who are having the recurrent cancers. Immunotherapy, multikinase therapies, these are the newer agents which could be tried in a patient with a breast cancer, this stomach cancer. Supportive treatment like nutrition, correction of the metabolic disorders, and the treatment of infection, and the to maintain the lumen patency, endoscopic laser stenting and the palliation could be given in these patients. So this is all about the gastric cancer. So we have seen in the gastric cancer, it can be presented as a pain in the abdomen or significant weight loss and anemia. The signs are only in the advanced stage of the disease which can be picked. The gold standard of the investigation is endoscopy, which can by which we can take the biopsy as well, and the resection of the treatment of the tumor is the resection of the tumor, and we can resect the tumor if the tumor is in distal stomach, we can remove the distal part and preserve the proximal part and do the Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy. And if the tumor is in the middle of the stomach or the proximal stomach, we have to do the complete total resection of the tumor, total resection of the total gastrectomy, and anastomose the jejunum with the esophagus, and by making the Roux-en-Y as I have shown you in the picture. And this is called Roux-en-Y esophagojejunostomy. And as I have discussed the and we have discussed the chemotherapy, use of chemotherapy, new and the adjuvant chemotherapies. Radiotherapy has very limited role, and the different chemotherapy agents could be tried, and the newer agents like the monoclonal antibodies, multi-kinase inhibitors, and the immunotherapies could be tried in the gastric cancers. The inoperable